You might have been hearing a lot about RAG, but what does it really mean and how easy can you get started and how effective can it be when trying to understand your data? Learn all about it and how you can use Azure AI Search and Microsoft Fabric to do it this week on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by Kay. Kay, thanks so much for joining us today on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Can you kick us off by telling us a little bit about who you are and what you do?
Firstly, thank you for having me. It's an honor to be with you, Anna. Thank you. So my name is Kay Sauter. I am a Microsoft MP from Switzerland. I live in Zurich. I'm a senior BI developer at a real estate management company here in Switzerland. So also I do some conference stuff. I share my knowledge also with Azure data user groups and have also a passion for DEI topics.
Awesome. Cool. And today we're going to be talking about RAG, which is maybe something people have been hearing a lot about and maybe something they haven't. So Kay, I'd love to kick off. Yeah, exactly. Like, what is RAG? And let's take a look.
Exactly. This is a question that maybe often comes up if you don't know what it means. It's a strange abbreviation, right? It means additive augmented generation, which is a part, actually a framework for generative AI, generative AI generation. So we have here in this case, what I'm going to show is Fabric. We have documents that we have in a lakehouse, for example, and those get actually indexed into a document preprocessing engine, which is called Azure AI Search. Then it goes to chunking and indexing, because if you have larger documents, you want to chunk them, and so only the chunks to get indexed. In our case, we want to have a lot of data, basically, because we only have some tables that we are going to show later. And then we get it into an embedding, which is an indexing machine to index your tokens to prepare it for the large language models. And from there, you can actually get an answer. So you do enter a prompt, enter a question, it goes to the embedding, it goes back to the model, and this is what we call RAG.
That helps a lot. Thanks so much. And so how difficult or easy is it to kind of do this with Fabric and Azure?
Well, it's I would say, like a lot of stuff, you have to just know how. And once you've done it a few times, it's relatively easy. So it's literally that way. But the concept, to understand it, to process it, to understand it, like it's oftentimes it's not so easy. But it's easy to get used to it. It's not it's super complicated either. It's just you have to get used to it, some concepts, and understand how it's done.
Cool.
So if you want me to, I can actually do the demo now and show you how it's done. So I'll share the screen. Like I said, first we have basically an index. We have deployments. We are in the Azure AI Studio. Here we see the index that we have is data exposed. We have deployments we do for the RAG. In this case, actually, I'm using GPT-35 Turbo 16K text embedding ADL-002. So we have something that we are using this in the, like I said before, for the embedding and also the large language model. So if you go back to Fabric, then we will see here that we have a lakehouse, and the lakehouse basically uses the data, I mean, using the data from Lakehouse and use a query that produces me the just a query, basically. It's a very simple model of it, very simple second model to have on another from the AdventureWorks Lakehouse. So we have some pandas. From here until here is actually quite straightforward. If you know Fabric and if you know some data engineering with a notebook. So you see the table here is actually generating a PDF, and the PDF are then put into a folder that's called PDF. And then we load this everything into this the RAG model. We are starting chunking here. We are starting to use some functions to prepare the model into the indexing, and then we get into in the end really to the indexing. We have success. The next is we have an app here that we basically initialize first to make sure that we have everything embedded as well. We get to the questions we want to ask, so we have to prepare the Fabric for this first, and then we have really the possibility to use prompts. And here is what when it gets interesting. We prepared it already. For example, a question here: what we can do is, can you display the financial actuals for all calendar year? If I generate it here now, immediately you will see it gets updated and gives me a slightly different answer, because it's, the answer is generated each time we actually start this. So here we see the actual code where we ask the question with a user question. We have a variable here with the question, can you display the financial actual for all calendar year? And it returns me the results that it has. And it's pretty accurate. It's actually, it's not always 100% accurate, but it's pretty accurate most of the time. So sometimes you have to really do trial and error and see if it succeeds, especially if it's these calculations. You even can do calculations and ask, for example, you can get change. Can you display this as a table and at the column change in percent? The change is actual for previous year, and if you say the dancer don't know, use following headers. You have to really be very precise and give very precise, clear instructions to the RAG model, so it knows what it does, it should do. And so you can see we actually put two tables, and it returns two tables, it does some calculations, and most of the times the percentage after the comma is here the point. In Switzerland it's comma, but after the point it's basically not really correct, but it's as you can see, it's very surprising how far it gets and what you can do. You also can do some text. Here, for example, it tries to also to give the Swiss performance index, or you could also, of course, NASDAQ or another index, and it tells you, I don't have access to this information because I did not build something like this to access it. For this, so this is also what you can give you back. I can't do that, for example. But you also can do other experiments, like can you write me a report of about A4 pages? And sometimes it gives you just a very short answers. Sometimes it gives longer access, a longer answer like this here, based on the context. We have really a text that put out very impressively. So what this RAG model means is you have a bit more possibility to steer what you actually could put out. Theoretically, you could also, like I said before, with the access from the internet is not possible, but I also could provide it to the RAG model with a screenshot or a PDF from Swiss Performance Index from that point on. So the extraction of the model via PDF would also work. So what cool. also is surprising, it seems it is possible to do in German, so in other languages. This is very surprising. Yeah.
Oh, wow. So even though all the data it was trained on was in English, it's still able to translate and answer your questions in German, no problem. That's amazing.
I even actually told in this case that it should use the Swiss formatting. So we have here formatting that is from Switzerland, actually. So we don't have the US American formatting. Even told it. So it does use the numbers for the formats for the Switzerland, and everything is in US dollar. So it understands and does do this. It's really amazing.
Wow, cool. Kay, this was super useful. Personally, I learned a lot. I'm sure your users did too. Really, the world is free for exploring and asking questions like this once you have this built. Totally appreciate you kind of like taking the hood up and showing us how to get this working. I think you're totally right that like this can be a lot to take in the first time, but once you get used to it, you can obviously see there's immense value. And then there's another skill around prompt engineering to try to get the answers that you're looking for. As we wrap, Kay, any final tips or tricks for folks who might be getting started with this?
Yes. So what I found out is that you really have to do trial and error. You have to see what works. Sometimes it works better than you might expect. Sometimes it works worse than you expect. But essentially, what works better is if you have less text, try to have very short, succinct messages to the RAG model, and try to have not too many noise into the data you're providing. For example, in my case, I only have queries that I put in, only tables that I put in, and I would expect if you have a lot of images, for example, and other noises like this, that this might be distracting for the model. So it's to have just a very succinct information you provide also in the PDF. So it extracts from there, and then you have more precise information.
Awesome. Cool. Well, thanks again, Kay, for coming on. I learned a lot. To our viewers, if you like this episode, go ahead, give it a like, leave us a comment, and let us know what you plan on using RAG for. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed MVP Edition.